Hello from snowy London and welcome to the latest session in today's event. My name is Katie Martin. I'm the markets editor at the FT in London. And we've got a really fun topic to discuss today, quite a provocative one in a way. Are bonds the new equities? I'm joined by an excellent, lively panel of people to chew through this issue in no particular order. They are David Roberts, who's the head of fixed income at Liontrust, James Bevan, who is the CIO at CCLA, hi there, and Zeynep Ozturk, who is from Citi Private Bank, where she's head of fixed income. Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. So, as I say, this is quite a kind of quite a spicy issue. What role does fixed income, what role do government bonds in particular play in a portfolio these days? So perhaps the best way to start is to discuss what role fixed income plays in your mandate, as it were. So Zeynep, tell us a little bit about what you do and how you approach this issue.
Thank you, Katie. Hi, and good afternoon, everyone. It's great to be part of this panel with James and David. So thank you for having me, first of all. So if I may briefly give a bit of a color in terms of what I do and what's the mandate that I'm in, so that hopefully it will give a bit of a context in terms of the things that I will share later on. As you mentioned, I'm part of Citigroup private wealth business, looking after the capital markets, a group predominantly focusing in fixed income as an asset class. So what we do is to work with our clients on an advisory basis to help them pick bonds and or invest in the broad spectrum of fixed income asset classes. So my mandate is 100% fixed income. Therefore, I have to make it work one way or the other. And we do picking in the best alpha within the asset class.
Good stuff. Thank you, Zeynep. What about you, David?
Yeah, good morning, good afternoon, one and all. Well, I spent a couple of decades or more running a lot of life and pension fund assets and also some mutual funds. And one thing I guess that taught me is that there are myriad reasons for owning any asset, not least of all bonds, and that sometimes price is not that important. So I would say the starting point for me is that to remember almost that irrespective of what we might think about value, a lot of our clients have little choice, sometimes as a result of regulation, but to own bonds. And for the last 3 or 4 years, I've been fortunate to concentrate purely in mutual funds and certainly more flexible ones. So that's given me the opportunity to work with clients to try to preserve value, collapse bond direction when things are expensive, and hopefully as they cheapen up a little bit in the next couple of years, also use that flexibility to increase a little bit of directional risk, which hopefully can capture some gain for, I say, what are predominantly a mutual fund buyer base.
And thank you for that. And James?
Yeah, I listened to David talking about the scandal that is the regulatory recognition of risk and the forlorn hope that somehow bonds can be described as low risk, when actually we can now regard them as no return, full risk assets. And the reality is that since the COVID-19 crisis, building on the experience of the post-global financial crisis policy initiatives, we now have bond yields driven to levels that are simply inconsistent with normal capital market systems. We have over $17 trillion of global bonds offering negative yields and a far greater number offering nominal yields below the rate of inflation. So for any investor, from my perspective, looking to protect the long-term real value of their assets or the attendant income stream, bonds are toxic, and that's simple and clear.
I mean, as James says, we do find ourselves at an extraordinary juncture in global markets right now. I mean, in response to the coronavirus crisis that broke out last year, obviously central banks have pumped trillions of dollars into the bond markets. And that just means that yields are incredibly depressed, as James says. So what does this mean for dedicated fixed income managers, you know, like Zeynep and David? I mean, how can you find strategies that work for you? I mean, Zeynep.
Thank you for appreciating the difficulty of our job. So that's true, and this is what I exactly tell my boss when the performance review time comes. So we're trying to navigate around a very tough stream, which comes really strong, and we're trying to pedal against it, which is not natural. However, again, it really depends on the type of investor and the type of mandate, I would say. So if I were very much constrained around pure investment grade or sovereign or very long duration, etc. type, very specific mandates, it would have been even more difficult. So the way we look at the fixed income market is much, much broader. So what I mean by that is, we look into all of the EM market, the local rates market, as well as derivatives, in addition to the core IG, US or Europe. It's been quite a long time that we've been steering away from European sovereign or even US right. Treasuries from a more buy and hold investments. It's for US Treasuries, it's more of a tactical positioning, getting in and out and trying to utilize the price appreciation or depreciation depending on the equity market flow. And we've been utilizing the quite strong supply in high yield market, in particular to US last year and even starting this year. As you might have followed, there has been still a strong supply coming in high yield, and there are certain sectors that we think have been significantly sold off unnecessarily than compared to what has happened in some of those similar names in their equity markets. Also, as I mentioned, we use derivatives quite closely, where we take hedges together with some duration risk. If there is a particular focus on, let's say, a high yield sector that we like to invest, at the same time using the CDX high yield, where the levels have been quite compressed and it's really a cheap hedge, even for an equity portfolio, we use them to balance the risk a little bit better. So when you have a bit more flexibility in terms of the type of markets that you can get in and out, and or if you're not constrained with a time period to hold, it gives you actually a good opportunity to generate an alpha, even in a market like this, because especially in a market like this, I would say, where we have a big price inflation, all the stimulus that is coming to market is not only inflating the equity prices, but also credit market quite heavily. Therefore, one should only use it in their advantage to sell when the market is in the right place and get in through the new supply of the new issue market.
So you have to think quite kind of laterally sometimes. I mean, David, does that resonate with you? Do you have to be more creative now? Sorry. Do you have to be more creative in fixed income strategies now than you were, say, 20 years ago when you started out?
If only it was just 20 years, Katie.
Sorry, just accept it.
A decade and a half to that. But no, it's a very good point. My view is straightforward. For the thick end of 30 years, it's been easy to be a bond manager or a bond investor. Yeah. You know, I'm not going to tell my boss, but sometimes you felt like you're going to be paid for doing nothing. But what we've seen, I think, probably in the last 18 months, probably really what we were seeing from the middle of 2019 was a bit of a shift. You know, there was an increasing recognition that after a decade or so of real problems trying to generate inflation, that at the tail end of 2019, prior to this awful situation we're in now, inflation globally and certainly at a G7 level had started to rise. you know, it's part of the reason that I changed focus to manage more flexible mutual funds was to give us the advantage or the opportunity to remove a lot of that market direction, because to me the market, bond markets per se, just looked insanely expensive, and today even more so. But we know why that is. You know, this is, there's no kind of surprise here. We know why markets are as expensive as they are, and I would echo Zeynep's comments precisely. For us, it's about control or removal of market direction, not being sucked into that last little bit of the bond rally, and looking for opportunities that combination of fiscal and monetary policy has now created, which, you know, in all honesty, we probably didn't see since about the 1980s or the 1990s. So that's created, I think, an opportunity where we know virus response, we know fiscal and monetary responses have varied globally, unlike perhaps the period, the decade after the financial crisis, where everyone was moving in the same. So I think there are more opportunities now to exploit that than perhaps we've had, as I say, probably for 10, maybe 20 or even 30 years. Quite exciting.
Right. Yeah, but so David used the words insanely expensive. James, you went as far as toxic. So for you, you know, what fixed income do you hold? I think I know the answer to this one.
Well, absolutely no government securities. What we hold are a series of quasi fixed interest exposures in areas like mezzanine debt, which I suspect has been relatively neglected, some structured fixed interest where people are prepared to pay up because it's complex and the big banks are not interested in relatively small scale issues with complexity. Equally, I think that there are contractual income streams such as music royalties that look and feel a little bit like fixed income, but where the probable forward returns are oh so much more attractive than conventional fixed to me.
Yeah, but really, unless you have to buy, you know, the government securities, as you mentioned, you just can't see the rationale at all. What about the kind of safety element?
Well, you know, it's really very interesting when one thinks about the role that fixed interest is supposed to play in a portfolio, which is to diversify and to allow investors to take less risk. The hard reality is that with rates nailed to the floor, I would say that they are an accident waiting to happen. And we have this challenge of return-free risk as opposed to a risk-free return. I think a portfolio with a risk profile that matches the customer's requirement requires a much more sophisticated approach to understanding the sources of risks and the opportunities to lay them off. In particular, I worry that if we are to experience an acceleration in inflation, both bonds and equities will suffer. The diversification benefits that people who hold bonds today against an overwhelming majority of equity exposure will discover that actually they're not protected at all.
You've preempted my next question very cleverly there. I mean, for a long time, you know, multi-asset portfolios have relied on this 60-40 split into, you know, using fixed income as a hedge. But Zeynep, what if James is right? What if fixed income and the rates market, the government bond market in particular, it is an accident waiting to happen? This isn't how the markets are supposed to work. How do we deal with this possibility?
I think it's a very valid point to look into going forward and a little bit further down towards the end of 2021 especially. But there has been a great report that was published recently by Citi's global market strategist, Matt King. I think it's available for the audience to reach as well. And what he's really pointing out, and I fully echo what he said, is that now we all get into the obsession of following the whole money market movements and how the actual stimulus and central bank actions are taking place without really looking into fundamentals as we used to. And the reason for that is all the main fundamentals of the economy, how a vaccine can impact the real economy, and then whether we can get a resolution, whether it will be good for governments, whether we will see more fiscal stimulus, etc. It all became a theory somewhere parked, and everyone, all the cash, excess cash that is sitting in the market, is following a certain pattern, and it's not fundamentals, I'm afraid. Therefore, what one can do is simply get depressed and look at all these news and completely say, I mean, I don't understand. It doesn't make sense, which I agree. But if you really need to take some action and not sit on the cash and suffer with the inflation expectation, which we also strongly agree, I fully agree with what David mentioned, you need to exploit the existing reality, which is that even with the Fed asset purchase program, and in addition to the shrinkage of the bank assets within the Fed, which created additional 1.5 trillion liquidity in the market, which is not recorded in Fed statements, but which is happening at the moment. I don't think there is a way to say, no, I'm not touching these assets. You have to, one way or the other, if this is your mandate, as I said, if I was an equity manager, it would have been a completely different ball game. But as long as you have to play around or take position in a market like this, I don't see we can completely avoid govies. Or even if you're avoiding govies, you cannot completely avoid the movement of the asset prices and take advantage as long as we hear the tapering is starting more towards the end of the 2021. So this is more of a reading through central bank statements type of a time for us, rather than trying to understand the long-term impact of the vaccination or the long-term impact of how governments are going to implement their fiscal planning. Because it's not a time where we were last in 2019. We are in a completely different dynamics, mainly because of COVID. Therefore, everything has to be pushed forward for all of the economies, even if it is optimal or not.
Yeah, and as you say, you know, the kind of Kremlinology that goes into scouring through Fed statements to try and pick up tiny clues about what's going to happen next, and tracking Fed speakers in particular, this has always been the game in markets, but it does feel heightened now. I mean, David, what are your thoughts on that? Does all of this sensitivity around what's going to happen next, when they're going to withdraw support, does that undermine fixed income as a ballast in portfolios? And before you answer, I would just say, the audience, you're very welcome to ask questions through the chat boxes on your screen. We will have time at the end to go through your questions, so don't be shy, fire away. But David, what do you think about fixed income as a ballast in mixed portfolios now?
Well, I think I shouldn't probably nail my fund colours to the mast. Coming back to the previous points and the sort of flagship fund I run, I'm currently 20% short government bonds with about, you know, no inflation protection at all. That was last year's story in my view. And about 70% of the assets in mildly inflation protected stuff, such as investment grade and high yield. So things that'll do okay as free money is still available and inflation creeps back. But again, I think to Zeynep's point, the further we move through this year, then the greater the probability of, I guess we could say, an inflection point, not just for bonds, but probably for all assets. At the moment, here we've hardly started 2021, and you know, if you're a domestic UK gilt investor, if you just buy the market, you're down what, 4%. So for bonds that are paying nothing, coming back to James' point, if you can wake up 4 or 5 weeks into the year and find you've lost 4% of your capital, not so great, and I don't think that's a sleep easy story, if I'm honest. Coming specifically back to that point, I do think that there is some evidence. We've already seen central banks test the waters with respect to tapering. Couple of weeks ago, we had four or five central banks, including well, the MPC, the Bank of England, the ECB, Bank of Canada, and I guess also probably the RBA, and maybe mildly, all round about the same time talking about not needing to use the full extent of the QE and how economies might be slightly better as we move through 2021 than expected. The reaction to that's clearly been to help push bond yields up 15, 20 basis points. Not huge, but certainly enough to have the bears coming out of hibernation. So I, whether we like it or not, it's certainly in this sort of modern world something that the people focus on. And yeah, I mean, it's just a fact of life. I would agree with Zeynep, it's something to try not to get too hung up on. If you're trading the market day to day, fine. But if you're trying to build portfolios and maintain value for long term clients, it's noise.
And when you virtually at least look into the whites of the eyes of policymakers at the major central banks at the moment, do you believe them when they say that they're going to remain accommodative for years to come? Or do you think that the reality of the recovery from COVID might force their hand to withdraw support earlier and potentially destabilize the market?
I think central banks and governments recognise they have an exceptionally difficult task to gently allow the bubble that has built in all asset classes to deflate. And I certainly anticipate that they will therefore do their level best to try to take the puff out of these elevated prices by only ever so slowly withdrawing support. And I don't think that people who are invested in the bond markets need worry about yields rising very significantly. For example, I would say that fair value for the US 10-year yield on my numbers is around 2 percentage points based on the relationship between the top price and the gold price. And that compares with the current price of around 1.2%. So it's not a huge shift unless indeed we get a very significant surge in inflation. And inflation, I think, is a really interesting challenge for all asset class investors. We know that inflation was held down because of some quite strong secular forces, such as deteriorating demographics, high levels of global indebtedness, disruptive technologies, and of course, globalization. And big picture issues such as will the North Asian command economies go for profitability or stick with wanting market share and full employment? Those are enormous issues. I think that Janet Yellen, in spending over $1 trillion between now and July of the US government's money at the Federal Reserve, is also very alive to the inflation risks. But she has a somewhat different agenda. And I think that actually what we will observe if there is a push up in inflation is that all asset classes suffer. And although I am not keen on bonds, I think that with equity space, it's going to be so important to focus on quality and structural growth to see yourself right through the down and up the other side again.
I mean, as you say, that the ramifications of other asset classes are pretty stark. You know, how much of the rally in equities do you think is accounted for by the depression of yields in the rates market?
I would say a huge amount. I would say that there are first order and second order events. And first off, lower bond yields clearly lead to higher equity risk premium and higher valuations. But equally, people, once they have fed on the expectation of rising prices, have been leveraging positions. That leveraging of positions has led to demand for collateral in the bond markets, which has further depressed yields. And thus the cycle has built. And I do think that we are now in a speculative phase in the market. I think that we are seeing bubbles in almost all asset classes. And this is a very tricky time for asset allocators. So I'm having a go not just at the government bond markets, but many asset classes where I see rampant speculation underpinning of solid fundamentals.
Yeah. I mean, Zeynep, you mentioned that interesting note from Matt King earlier this week, where he's talking about exactly that. You know, policymakers are effectively targeting asset prices these days. I mean, how much, you know, how dangerous do you think this is for other asset classes?
I mean, I fully agree what James has said. It impacts all the asset prices, and then eventually the economy is quite badly. But at the same time, I think what all the policymakers are hoping for, because it's a very difficult job to do, especially in an environment like this, that is that they cannot pull back now. They have to move on and carry on. And with the whole inflation in asset prices, where while the initial aim was that there will be actual stimulus in real economy and actual real inflation, which didn't happen, but the inflation has already been more absorbed by the asset prices, that the hope is that if this eventually will drill down into the economy over time, with the COVID impacts getting less and less severe as they are now. So, as of now, none of the central banks can really, even though they do test from time to time, they cannot really pull out. And as we have seen since March last year, in 2020 March, the big sell-off market has created even more instability around all markets. Even the local emerging countries have followed exactly the same pattern of the G10 central banks, that they had to keep up and they had to support the markets, even if it doesn't really work in the way they all want to achieve. But the influence of central bankers with the more political arena and trying to convince the governments into finding the better fiscal rather than just infrastructural based spending in their stimulus is the broader and the longer term solution, is I think is what we are interpreting.
And are you, how do you feel about this debate around whether this time is different for inflation? You know, people have been looking for an upsurge in inflation ever since the financial crisis of more than a decade ago. It simply never arrived. But is this form of fiscal stimulus that we're seeing now, which is much more directly into people's pockets, does that heighten the risk this time around for you?
I mean, I think so. And it's not just that. It's also the deficit, demand deficit in GDP, has been so distorted. And as soon as the economies are coming back into before COVID, as close to before COVID times as possible, then you can see a huge demand surge, which will be pushing prices even more. And as of now, with some of the difficulties around the movement of goods around the world with COVID, and for example for UK with the Brexit, all these difficulties that we have seen in actual transition of the goods and being able to reach on a timely manner created some sort of a price distortion already. And we don't see them in the CPI index directly, because CPI index has a certain basket that they measure, but on everyday life or in businesses, definitely in certain cases where we deal with certain private capital who are owners of big companies and moving and buying and selling goods, in trade finance businesses, etc., you see the impact already. So it will and which creates the expectation of inflation high, and that expectation is pushing the actual inflation further high. So I think we are in a completely different place now than we were back in 2018.
I mean, David, for you, is this a more live risk than it has been over the past few years?
It's as live a risk as it has been since the end of 2019. As I say, we've had more inflation, so you just use headline CPI. There's been more inflation around than central banks have been admitting to, one way of putting it. But coming back to what James said earlier, you know, the bond market was trading economies that was lending to G7 governments and a lot of investment grade companies below prevailing CPI 18 months ago. And that's before we've gone through some of what I think Zeynep's correctly identified as potential structural rather than cyclical inflationary forces, which are, you know, partly as a result of the pandemic, unfortunately. But those don't look to be going away too soon. And then, of course, the third thing to add to this is we've not really mentioned fiscal policy. So, again, if you the 2% CPI rate before G7 governments spend, what, the thick end of $15 trillion, an awful lot of which has been saved. If you look at the savings rate in the US and Europe and various other developed economies. So there's not just pent-up demand, in my opinion, but there's also the capability to draw down on wealth. Obviously, to an extent, it depends on the evolution of unemployment once we come out of the current lockdown and government-supported employment schemes. But there is clearly the possibility that what we're in now is the initial stages of what could be a longer-term structural change to see inflation coming back more into markets than we have seen for a couple of decades.
Yeah. I mean, it feels a little bit weird to go back to your earlier point that everyone's talking about the possibility of a global pickup in inflation, but at the same time, everyone's talking about the possibility of negative rates in the UK. As you mentioned, gilts have had a tricky start to the year, but what do you think the impact of that debate, at least in the UK, is?
Well, again, the funds I manage are global, so although I'm based in the UK, we can afford to avoid the UK. We were running with negative duration in UK bonds, so we own some UK credit, but sold UK government futures against that. So we effectively had a net negative exposure, which we closed out when yields hit 0.5%, which is still ridiculously low, but at least it made a few pennies for our clients. The bottom line for the UK and for most G7 governments is, again, I think this echoes what the other panelists have said, that we can tolerate a degree of rising bond yields, especially longer dated yields, if governments are able to fund way below either nominal or real growth out to sort of 5 to 10 years. So whether UK base rate is moderately negative or moderately positive, I don't really think makes that much of a difference. It's unlikely that we'll see short dated gilts. I think James made the point, it's unlikely we're going to see yields in the UK at the short end rise, materially above 30 or 40 basis points in the next few months. So my opinion specifically with respect to the UK, it doesn't make a huge degree of difference. I'm not an expert on the detail of the implementation, but again, perhaps picking up on Zeynep's point earlier, it would potentially just be another cost to doing business, and hence another minor addition to a cyclical inflation recovery.
Yeah, I mean, the nuts and bolts of getting this done are tricky, as the Bank of England itself is finding. but James, what do you think? Do you think it would be, as the other speakers have said, it would possibly not make that much difference whether it pivots a tiny bit either side of zero, the base rate, or would you take a different view?
I think that negative rates are very hostile to the banks. We have seen real challenges for banks operating in environments where there are negative rates. And, if one looks at the absurdity of the challenges, the target 2 system in the euro world, where the Bundesbank has to provide money to target 2. Of course, they don't have any money themselves, so they have to go to their commercial banks and say, guys, send us the money. And then, of course, they follow up that request for capital with a bill because of negative rates. How absurd can it get? And I do think that central banks are going to wrestle substantially with this challenge of inflation. If one goes back to what happened in the wake of the global financial crisis, enormous amounts of money were delivered. They certainly created significant asset price inflation. You try to buy a house almost anywhere in the world, you will discover that they are now at a heady multiple of local average earnings in almost all jurisdictions. Equally, a large chunk of the cash that was created by the US quantitative easing procedures did not go to raising consumer demand and, by extension, consumer prices for an imbalance of supply. Interestingly, went off to fuel a supply side expansion in China. But then, of course, was deflationary rather than inflationary. And therefore, I think tracing where the money goes and doesn't go is a really important part of the challenge. Go back to the points that both Zeynep and David have made. There's an awful lot of cash still sitting on household balance sheets that could be spent. And I think that the huge question ask allocators and economists is the cash going to be spent or is the cash going to be invested? And I'm drawing a subtle but significant distinction as to whether that money goes into crisis. I think that last year there was inadequate supply side investment, and therefore we will likely see supply side investment inflation followed by demand driven inflation and quite a pickup in the consumer price index numbers. If, however, the money is allocated to investments, there's no reason why we should have inflation for quite a long period.
Yeah. A lot does come down, obviously, to what we, you know, those of us who've been lucky enough to save the cash, what we do when this is all over. I mean, we're all kind of itching to go on holiday and go to the pub and all the rest of it. But who knows when that might happen.
Katie, may Zeynep, I just briefly add one quick point on that? When you mentioned what will the central banks will do when inflation, or if inflation starts to pick up in an environment where they are trying to keep very low, even negative rates, I think this is the biggest topic of discussion for economists now. That you can see in between lines of the open market operation reports. So the most of the central bankers or economists are arguing or reviewing all the potential theories out there to understand how can they still maintain low rates even if inflation starts to pick up. So interesting topic. I find it quite fascinating, to be honest with you, but I don't think central banks will jump into wagon of what they were saying. Oh, if the inflation picks up, we'll then taper and rise the rates. I don't think that will be the plan anytime soon.
I mean, that's the thing. They have experience of this, right? They know what happened in 2013 when the Fed chief at the time, Ben Bernanke, just started talking about tapering and the markets went crazy. And this is not what they want to see now. So do you think they've learned from that experience?
I think so, but again, this time is a slightly different experience. Therefore, what while trying to accommodate the economic stimulus, hoping to get a little bit more balanced in the fiscal and the monetary, and see as a result if the inflation starts to pick up, it wouldn't mean that, okay, we're in a great position now, we can potentially increase the rates. They need to have to maintain low rates for a little longer and start reducing increased debt in the industry gradually rather than very quickly. So that will be the difficult balance for the central banks.
So David, an interesting question that's come in from the audience, and just to reiterate, do feel free to ask your questions, is obviously everyone's grasping around looking for yield. How far along the risk curve are you prepared to go to find that yield?
Not at all. I mean, this is one of the things, the paradoxes of bond investment. People, you know, frequently forget that it's a balance between income and capital. And quite frankly, the further you chase yield, the more you put your capital at risk. I think that there are some very good opportunities in relative value within fixed income at the moment, particularly within core rates markets. And those can certainly enhance total return, if not necessarily boost income. So I just think it's a really good question, one we are asked pretty much every time we engage with clients. But there is no getting away from it. The higher the yield, the higher the degree of income one chases, then generally the greater the risk to one's capital. And as both James and Zeynep have pointed out, you know, it's not just government bonds. You know, pretty much every part of the market is really, really expensive. Having said that, if you asked me, what would I, you know, is where looks a sensible investment, say for a medium term investor, so over maybe the next 3 years. Yields in the high yield market have clearly fallen significantly, particularly since this time last year. But with money remaining generally free and there being little pressure in terms of debt servicing, then owning the generic high yield market and holding it for 2 or 3 years will generate an income, a yield, if you like, of 11-12% over that period. And given the other opportunities around, relatively speaking, that to me strikes me as being quite attractive. In absolute terms, perhaps less good, but you know, we are unfortunately living in a world, as certainly James and Zeynep have both pointed out, where everything is expensive, and it's the proverbial winner of the least ugly rather than the beauty contest, unfortunately.
Yes, exactly.
Can I put a question to David?
Please do.
Sorry to butt in. I'm
no, taking my job, go right ahead.
Where in the world of risk would one sit? Because when I think about risk in bonds, I guess lots of people are thinking about default risk, and I think about inflation risk and volatility. And I suspect with yields being where they are, volatility risk is going to be really very high indeed. And I think there is also an interesting complexity risk. And I wonder, David, how much you are looking at some of the more esoteric forms of risk, where a number of managers roll their eyes and think, gosh, that's a bit difficult, I'm not going to bother. I see plenty of nuggets of real value in areas such as structured mezzanine debt. Is that an area you look at?
In all honesty, James, is it no? The reason for that is straightforward. We are running daily priced mutual funds, so we do value liquidity right, yep. very, very highly. And the breadth of our remit is generally G7. Hard currency and stripping out equity, quasi-equity and foreign exchange. So the type of thing that, coming back to your point, I think it's hugely important that we're living in this world, of the tail end of this world, where volatility and complexity, value at risk, are, I think, totally misunderstood. There's a generation, at least, of investors who don't understand that. If that central bank, well, Zeynep put it very well, you know, we had the token attempt to remove the central bank put a few years ago, and that just created, you know, a ripple across all markets that historically would have been unexpected. So within what we are doing, so we're very, very conscious that, you know, the more investment grade or high yield debt that we add, then in the medium to long term, the greater the risk that there is for clients. So as we try not to chase yield. We don't move down the capital structure, and we'd much rather, for example, be, you know, long Swedish bonds and short German bonds, where
right.
as we move through the economic cycle, some of those points that James has just made are easier to understand. We understand, we have decades of information about the relative performance of those assets in the good times and the bad. So we would much rather focus there and try and make some alpha for clients rather than, exactly as James said, move into some of the more complex parts of the market.
So James, to take the flip side of that, you know, the flip side of looking for opportunities is looking for safety. Given where we are in the, particularly in the government bond market at the moment, If you look ahead, say, 5 years, what is the safe asset of the future for portfolios?
Well, I think it is a focus on quality free cash flow. I think that trying to connect price and value at the moment is extremely difficult. What I would observe, however, is that if one is able to purchase a free cash flow yield that is reasonable and growing, in the context of value being a relative rather than an absolute concept, I think that's where the greatest capital gain, the greatest safety will be expressed on a five-year view.
What about you, Zeynep? I mean, do you feel like we should stop referring to this market as the haven asset?
Not necessarily. Like, there are many many ETFs, bond ETFs that are quite solid that we like, for example. But if I were to put money into a mid to long term, and for me, long term is 5 years, not even beyond that, I would more look into structures where we take advantage of the curve steepening in US, because it's also a nice inflation protection. So one of the convictions that we have at the minute is to use the spread, the increased spread between 5s and 30-year swap curve, which has inverted only twice in its history. And it is definitely going to pick up, in my opinion, over the next 3 to 4 years, even more. Again, it can be a good protection for potential inflation increase as well.
Yeah.
But if I'm more looking into tactical, which we do quite often, we like trading in and out within 6 to 8 months
yeah.
or 12 months period, where emerging market debt definitely shows much better value.
Yeah.
Mainly, there has been a big sell-off in certain markets, way more than expected. Therefore, they do actually give good value to get in places like Latin America or some of the North Africa.
Yeah. Yeah, and inflows into EM debt have been enormous over the fourth quarter of last year and into the start of this year, but we're still not back to where we were before COVID, right? So there's still space
Correct.
For appreciation there. Yeah, yeah. What about you, David? What's your safe asset of choice these days?
I think it's difficult to find one, as I say, in bond land. What do we mean by safe? For me, it's not just about, it's about preservation of value. So, you know, if we've inflation at 2%, 1 or 2%, we're talking just to preserve your value. And that's quite difficult to find without going down the curve. I think coming back to James' point, solid and increasing free cash flow, especially in investment grade and high yield, is where we are. I can't disagree with those comments at all. That's exactly the part of the market we like. Don't get sucked into the cyclical recovery areas. It's about solid long-term opportunity. The other thing, very last thing for me, is I do worry a little bit about some of the inflation hedges. For me, last year was the time to be buying those. We've seen 10-year break-even rates in the US move from what, about 0.5% to about 2.1. They can go further, but it feels as if the easy money has been made. Likewise in
yeah.
Europe, you know, Italian index linked were trading on a negative yield this time last year. They're now at 1.1, which isn't too far away from
yeah.
long-term European inflation. So there's a word of caution there, but I would echo the previous comments. Nice, steady, stable, and preferably a little bit growing free cash flow is exactly where we would like to be, even within bond land. Mm.
James, we're kind of getting towards the end of our time limit, but you know, one of the issues that we've been talking about broadly in markets recently is that lots of parts of the equity market, the cryptocurrency markets, you look at what's happened with GameStop recently, there are lots of parts of the equity market that need to come with a health warning. Do you think it's time to really look at the rates market in that kind of way as well? It's something that we're warning about rather than labeling as a safe bet.
Yes and no. I don't see a flaw to the valuation of cryptocurrencies. They are only what willing buyers and sellers are prepared to exchange. There isn't a fundamental basis for value, nor is a central bank or government overseeing the protection of value for citizens of the country involved. GameStop, I do think, has value, but I reckon that the value of GameStop is all of $3, and therefore the downside risks from current markets are huge. In contrast with government debt, as long as one chooses one's government with a degree of care, one will get back what one anticipates one will receive at the point of purchase. And for that reason, I think the people who worry about the return of cash rather than the return on cash, government bonds still are a reasonable place. And to go right back to the very beginning of the conversation, when David was talking about the regulatory recognition of risk and mark-to-market accounting, there are still investors who will have to continue to hold bonds because their liabilities are measured in bond yields, and therefore they may wish to hold assets that mimic the nature of their liabilities, because that for them is containing risk.
Yes, exactly. And Zeynep, I imagine where you're coming from, this is just a part of a market that you really can't avoid. So it's just about making the best of the opportunities that are out there.
That's exactly the case. But at the same time, I really like what James said, whether you want to get your cash back or the return
yes.
on the cash. So how do you measure? What is your measurement or expectation? So we have seen really good pickup in majority of the sovereign risk that we've taken across the globe, not just US and G10, but we like looking into some of the Asia Asian sovereign, or as I said, LATAM, some of the Central European govies. So there is definitely an opportunity, and governments do pay back.
Yes, definitely. We are bang out of time, but thank you to James, David and Zeynep for a really engaging discussion. Please join us for the next one.